don't have a quiz today, and your quiz next week will be on the content from this lecture and your DLs this week. So you're not going to be quizzed on capacitors and exponential change. You will have a final question on those things, so it's important to know them. But we're switching gears now, and that stuff is not going to show up until June. That being said, I will post at least one practice question about capacitors and exponential change, along with the practice quizzes I post for next week. So most of the practice quizzes will be on this stuff, vectors and forces and whatnot. I'll give you some practice with that. So if you're struggling or really fed up with the stuff we're doing now, great, because we are not going to do it. You will be responsible for it in the end. So let's pivot to our new material. So far, we've only been talking about scalar quantities. A scalar is just something with a magnitude and maybe units. They have no direction. So something like mass, energy, temperature, pressure, speed. If something's 5 kilograms, it's 5 kilograms. There's no such thing as like 5 kilograms up or down, east, like direction not necessary. Same thing with energy. If I have 4 joules, there's 4 joules. It has no direction as part of that. There are things like speed, which could have a direction, in which case it'd be a velocity. So if we do add a direction to something, we call that a vector quantity. Still has a magnitude. For velocity, maybe like 3 meters per second. That's how fast something is moving. But it also has a direction, whether it's up, down, east, west, left, right, 30 degrees north of east, whatever it is. So examples for that, well, velocity, first of all. Velocity is just what happens when you have a speed and you assign it a direction. So speed is the magnitude of velocity, or like the strength of it. So if something is moving 3 meters per second, great, that's my speed, but we'd like some more information. You want to know, is that 3 meters per second moving directly toward my head, or directly toward your head, or to the left, or up, whatever. So direction does make sense and is meaningful for something like velocity. We'll see force and momentum later today. Those are other vectors that have both a magnitude and a direction. And finally, something like position. So position, magnitude and direction are important, right? If I want to describe how to get from me to the exit, then I need both, it's 30 meters, but if I just say 30 meters, that's not enough information for someone to figure out how to get from me to the exit. I need to say 30 meters that way. So I need to assign the direction to it. I didn't list it here, but the magnitude of position is just length or distance, right? That would be the 30 meters part. The direction would be 2 o'clock or northeast or something like that. So a lot of quantities, we can learn something about their magnitude, but the direction, turning it into a vector, is a whole lot more meaningful. So we're going to talk about how to represent them first graphically, which is just visually in drawings, which is just an arrow. And it's a pretty intuitive way to see it. The direction is, just where the arrow is pointing. So if I want a vector that points northeast, I'll draw an arrow that points northeast. And the magnitude of that is just that vector's length. So a longer vector is going to have a greater magnitude, or something with a smaller magnitude, shorter vector. So here's some force, and I know I'm going to say force a lot today, but it's not really, we'll define it more specifically later on, but for now, a force, we know what a force is. You push something, you pull something, you apply a force to it. That's all we need, but it has a direction, right? I can push something left, push something right, whatever. So we have a force. If I wanted to double the strength of the force, I would represent that by making this arrow twice as long. If I wanted to push it in the other direction, I'd put the arrow pointing the opposite way. Okay, so that's how we represent them graphically. Magnitude is the length. Direction is where it's pointing. And we'll often there's a bunch of different ways we can describe direction. Like I said before, I could say 2 o'clock, I could say northeast, I could say 30 degrees north of east, or you know, something like this, be very quantitative about it. But at the end of the day, as long as you give enough information to know, it doesn't really matter how you say the direction of a vector. But there's two quantities, the angle or the direction and the magnitude. So just an example here, let's say we have two position vectors, x1 and x2. And these have x1 goes up and x2 goes to the right. They're both position vectors, so this would be just describing something that is up and then something else that's to the right. So they point in different directions, and x2 has a greater magnitude than x1, which means that just the point that x2 is describing is further away from this origin than the point that x1 is describing, right? It's a longer arrow. So I'm kind of talking about something that's pretty intuitive, right? I think if we just look at this, x1 points to a point that's there, and x2 points to a point there, and x2 is further away. So for positions, drawing vectors is pretty intuitive. The important thing here that I don't really mention is that we need to know the origin. So where these vectors are coming from. If I want to describe a position, like let's say where the exit is, and I say it's 30 meters to, like in the direction of 2 o'clock, great, but you need to know where I am for that to be useful. And in fact, it's incorrect for any of you. Whatever directions I give, my position vector to the door is different than yours. So it is important to specify the origin for position vectors. Let's take a look at another example. We have two velocities. This is one thing that's moving to the right with some speed in this direction. So speed plus a direction gives us a velocity. We know it's a vector because it has this little arrow over it, which maybe I didn't say that explicitly, but vectors, we denote them by just putting a little arrow over them. V1's moving to the right. V2 is another thing that's moving to the right as well, but V2 is not moving as quickly. Whatever this object is not moving as quickly. V1 is a longer vector, and so it has a greater magnitude, it's moving faster. So if we played this out, V1 would catch up with V2, right? But they're both moving in the same direction. Both velocity vectors, both pointing in the same direction, which is positive x, or to the right. I'll introduce this a little more explicitly later, but I think we mostly know this. X is our horizontal axis, and y is our vertical axis. there's nothing inherent about x and y. It's just convention in a lot of fields. So positive x is to the right. Positive y is up. Negative x is to the left. Negative y is down. OK, great. Origin is not super important for speed, right? Much later in the quarter, we'll talk about, kinematics, which is when we actually use speed over time to get a distance and see when things might collide and stuff like that. But right now, it's not super important, right? If I want to tell you something's moving 3 meters per second to the left, it's not super important whether it's here or whether it's there. So there's no really general rule right now when we need to specify an origin and when we don't, but I think it's pretty intuitive, right? If I want to describe where something is, I need to know where it is in relation to something. So it's just more something to mention, not really something that you'll be responsible for, but it's something to keep in mind, that a vector does have a direction and a length, but it also starts somewhere. So how do we add them? So we know what these vectors mean, right? F1 is some force pointing that way, and it's stronger, has a greater magnitude than F2, which is another force that's, like we said, weaker, but pointing down and to the right. So how do we put them together? Well, we add them tip to tail, we might say. That's the rule for adding vectors. But I think an even easier way to see it is just to just add them consecutively. Put them on top of each other, one after the other. Don't rotate it. Don't change its length, just pick it up, slide it over after the next one. And then they should just lead in. Tip to tail means from the start to the end, or from the point to the arrow, and it should just follow a path. So now once we add them together, once we put them tip to tail, we have a start and an endpoint. And our final, our net vector, what we wanted, f1 plus f2, is just the vector that goes from our start to our end. So algebraically, this is just f1 plus f2 is fnet, and fnet is what happens when you put them one after the other, tip to tail. Same thing if we had even more. Let's say we had a third vector, f3, that we wanted to add on. I just take f3, put it on the end of f2, and we get a new endpoint. And so our fnet is now going from our initial start to our endpoint, and algebraically, it's just the sum of all three. And as we'll see in a little bit, the order that you add them doesn't matter. You can't go wrong. If I had started with f3 and then put f1 at the end of that and then put f2, you'd get the same fnet. So we don't have to worry about the order. You get the same result. We'll see that more explicitly in a sec. So here's a clicker question for you. We have these vectors, f1 and f2. What is fnet? So if I add them together, f1 plus f2, which of these vectors will I get as a result? Give you maybe 30 more seconds with this. All right. I'm going to call it there. We did a nice job with this one. So the answer is C, this vector pointing up and to the right. Initial way we might check that is just, well, f1 goes up and f2 goes to the right. So if I add them together, my final answer should go up and to the right. But if we want to do that explicitly, we can write out our equation graphically. F1 plus f2 is what happens when I put them tip to tail, and then draw a new vector from start to finish. So this way, I did it f2 plus f1, and I get that fnet, which was answer C. But I could also do f1 plus f2. Order does not matter at all. We get the same fnet no matter what. It's just a triangle with each one of those vectors is a side. So the order of addition doesn't matter. How do we subtract vectors? Well, I say we just make it addition. We could make a new rule with how we line them up and stuff, but I think it's easier to see if we know f1 minus f2 is the same as f1 plus negative f2. Right? So we just took the minus sign and turned it into a plus a negative. The only thing we have to change is that if I make f2 negative, that just means I flip it around. So making a vector negative, multiplying it by -1, is just putting the arrow on the other side, reversing its direction. All right? And now I just have an addition problem. This vector plus this new vector, which is negative f2. So I take that one, negative f2, put it on the end of f1, and we know our addition rule. We take our start, go to our end with our new vector, and so the difference, f1 minus f2, or f1 plus negative f2 is just this vector that I labeled f diff here that goes from our start to our finish. So clearly f1 plus f2 and f1 minus f2, if you remember what it looked like before, which I'm not even sure I really do, give us two different vectors. The sum gave us something like that, which is below f1, and the difference gave us something that goes above f1. So that's how we subtract. Just make it addition. Okay. So how do we do it algebraically? Graphically, addition, we just take them, line them up one after the other, tip to tail, and draw a new vector from start to finish. Subtraction, same process, except we'll just turn it into addition by making any minus signs plus negatives, and then just use our addition rule. But what if we're given vectors in terms of their magnitude and their direction, so numerically? So I have vector one here, say it's 4 newtons, which is the unit of force. Again, right now, forces are just pushes and pulls in some direction. We'll go into the specifics of them later on. But 4 newtons, 30 degrees north of east. Great. That tells me what this vector is. I know how strong it is and where it's pointing. Same thing with vector two, has some magnitude, 2.5 newtons. So it's weaker than force one, but it's pointing in a different direction. In this case, 60 degrees north of west. Great. So individually, this is great. This is good information. It tells us where the vectors are pointing and how strong they are. However, there's no clear way to add them together, right? So I know graphically I could just take this one, put it there, draw a new vector. Great. But if I just have this information here, how do I add 30 degrees north of east to 60 degrees north of west? That we can't do. So we need to use another method, right? So it's a good way to communicate. It's a good way to, if I want to tell you what a single vector is, just telling you its magnitude and the direction is great, because you could draw it and know what it does, but it's not a good way to solve problems with more than one force. So what we're going to do is break vectors down into their x and y components. So here's my force, F1. And if I draw some axes on here, my x direction, as I said before, is our horizontal. Our y direction is our vertical. I can break F1 down. Instead of having a magnitude, a length, and a direction expressed as an angle, I can express it as a length in the x and a length in the y directions. Right? So this vector, F1, can basically be described as a point. So its x component is just how long the vector is in the x direction, F1x. And its y component is just its length in the y component, F1y. So that uniquely describes this vector just as well as having a length and an angle, right? If I gave you a length and an angle, you could draw this. But also, if I gave you an x and a y component, you could plot that point and draw your vector, same thing. So this gives us the same information, except now we have two clear quantities that we'll see are much easier to combine with other vectors in the xy plane than it is with this length and direction terminology. So again, our vector, F1, now instead of magnitude and direction, we have x component, y component. And here I have it listed as just like a little pair of points. But we can list any vector like this, x component, comma, y component. So now I have F2. This is the vector from before where I said this is like 2.5 newtons, 60 degrees north of west. But now I have it in its x component, which is this is a negative x component. It goes to the negative x side, to the left, and a y component. So now if I want to add these together, instead of trying to figure out how to use the angles and how those combine together, I can just do it component by component. I can get the x and the y sum, and then put them back together into an F net. So there's a lot to take in conceptually here. But really, what we're saying is that when we break down vectors into their x and their y components, as I've done here, we can solve the problem completely separately, the x part of it and the y part of it. So if I want to add, if I want to find the net F1 plus F2, I can do F net x, which is F1x plus F2x, and F net y, which is just F1y plus F2y. And then my F net is just a new vector with the components F net x and F net y. So now we don't have to worry about angles or anything, because remember the relationship between x and y, that tells us where this vector points. So we've already taken care of it. We have enough information. And the x and y components are completely independent. So that means there's nothing wrong with breaking this up and doing the problem completely separately. Instead of vectors with two components, we can just have all x over here, and that's just addition and subtraction, all y over here, addition and subtraction, and then putting them together. Another way to think of them being completely independent is if you think about our x and our y directions, they're perpendicular, right? Y is up and down, x is left and right. There's no change in x, so I can't add or subtract any amount of x in the horizontal that will affect my y, my vertical, right? If I change x, I only change x. Same thing with y. If I change y, I only change y. No vertical change will ever give me any change in x. So completely independent, 2D problems are really just two 1D problems. Another way to see this visually, if we're adding them up, f1 plus f2 is f net, right? So just f1 plus f2, and then the components add as well. F net x is just f1x plus f2x. Here's my f net x component. And f net y is just f1y plus f2y. There's my y component of my f net. So however you want to visualize it, two separate problems, x and y. So let's kind of combine these graphically and algebraically. Graphically, I have my f1, and I want to add f2 to it. So like we saw before, I just take f2, put it at the end of f1. Now we have them following each other tip to tail, and I draw my f net from my start to my finish. Great, that's how I did it graphically. And then algebraically, my f net was just the sum of the x components is the x component, and the sum of the y components is the y component. In the y direction, it's very easy to see, right? We have f1y was the vertical piece of f1, and then f2 had another vertical piece that was also going up, and so we just get f1y plus that additional f2y, and that's how we get our final f net y, which is just the sum. Same thing in the x direction, except the little bit trickier part is that f2 has a negative x component. So this f2x is a negative number because it goes to the left in the negative x direction. So my fx, if my f1x, my initial, was to here, and then when I add on the f2x, it actually brings me back a little bit because it's negative. If I add left to a right, it takes away from it. And so our f net is pointing slightly less to the right than f1 and pointing more up, if you want to see it qualitatively that way. But this is how the x and y components are split up and then put back together into a single one. Questions on any of this part? Let's do a clicker question. So we have now two vectors that I give you the components of, and I want you to add them together into an fnet. So what are the components of fnet if I add f1 and f2 together here? About 15 more seconds. All right, I'm going to stop us there. All right, 100% on this one. Nice work. The answer is A. Our F1 is negative 1, negative 2. F2 is 3, 0. So if we add those together in the x direction, f net x is the sum of negative 1 and 3, so we get 2. And f net y is the sum of negative 2 and 0, so we just get negative 2. So our f net vector is just putting those back together as components, two, negative 2. And I've done it graphically up here. I've added those two vectors together, and this f net is the red vector, the result, the addition of them. And Our components say it should go to the right, positive x, and down, negative y, which this does, right? This vector is pointing to the right and down. And the magnitude in both directions is 2, 2 and negative 2, so it should be roughly the same amount of down as it is right, which seems to be what we have here. You good on this? All right, so now we have this nice way of doing problems algebraically. We break any vector down into its x, horizontal, and its y, vertical components, and then we can do those separate problems and put them back together to get our final answer for our vector, our f net. But how do we find the components from a magnitude and a direction? So let's say we're given the magnitude, which this is a new symbol here, just putting a vector in absolute value symbols, like in between these two lines, just means that it's the length, the magnitude of it. So magnitude of f, absolute value of vector f, is just the length of this vector, and direction, I say, is this angle theta, which is just how far above the x-axis is it. So this is a great description of this vector. Again, it's a very good way to communicate it because, well, we can draw it nice and easy. It tells us where it is. But if I want to add this to other vectors or do some math with it, I want my fx and my fy. So what are my components? How do I find them from the magnitude and direction? And the answer is trigonometry. Just real quick, the fx and fy here, we can also think of them as their own vectors, right? So we know the way vectors add is by adding them tip to tail. If I had one vector fx that goes only along the x-axis, there's no y component, and some vector fy that only goes in the y direction, there's no x component, those two will add up to my original vector, f. So you can see these as like sides of a triangle, right triangle, that add up to the vector. So we don't really mark them as vectors, right? Because this is really just the length, this fx. This is just the length, fy. But we could see them as vectors that add up to make the vector that they are components of. Anyway, so how do we find these components? Well, trigonometry. So I just took this low-resolution graphic from Google Images, but I recommend if this is not fresh on your mind or a bit confusing, before you delve into any of the material this week, just take 5 or 10 minutes, watch a YouTube video or two of someone doing a bunch of simple trig problems. It will really help to refresh your memory now. But as a quick review, we have sine, cosine, and tangent. These are all useful, well, in this case, for only right triangles. So that means where one of the angles, this one on the left here, is a right angle, 90 degrees. And the way we use them is we identify some one of the angles. So in this case, it's this purple shaded one near point B. Sine is opposite over hypotenuse. So that's this AC over AB. So it's the one that's opposite the angle, like facing the angle over the hypotenuse. Cosine is for the adjacent one. So that's for the side that makes up part of this angle and the hypotenuse. Hypotenuse is just the longest side of the triangle that does not connect to the 90-degree angle. And tangent is when we have just the opposite and the adjacent. So this acronym here, SOHCAHTOA, sine, opposite, hypotenuse, cosine, adjacent, hypotenuse, tangent, opposite, adjacent. Anyway, get comfortable with this stuff. We won't have to do really complex trig, but when you're doing a problem and you're focusing on the physics concepts, you really don't want this getting in your way of your physical understanding. Okay, so the way that applies to a problem like this, we have our magnitude and direction. Fx is going to be f cosine theta, because fx is our adjacent leg of the triangle, right? Here, this is the theta we're talking about. Fx is the adjacent side, the one that's next to it. So we get cosine, and fy is the one that is opposite. So fy is the magnitude of f times sine theta as the opposite one. However, highly recommend that you do not just memorize this configuration here and burn it in your brain that that x is cosine and y is sine, because what if I gave you this angle as theta? In this case, my fx, my opposite, is fx. So my opposite here it's the dotted line above this triangle, but these two triangles are equivalent. So that's one, if this distance is fx along the x-axis from the origin to the dotted line, then this distance up here is also fx. Same thing with fy. If origin to the dotted line in the vertical direction is fy, this is also fy, right? Just a rectangle. So anyway, if I label this as theta, in that case, my x is the opposite angle, is the opposite side, and my y is the adjacent side. So this relationship gets flipped. Here my fx is sine, and my fy is cosine. So be very careful. Depending on which angle you're given, this will change. So that's just me saying you should learn the trig concepts, at least at a basic level, because you should apply them each time instead of just memorizing how to get the angles. This will become even more important when we deal with things on angles and stuff like that, when maybe our x and y might be tilted. There's a lot of different things that could happen. So anyway, be careful. If we want to find the inverse relationship, so we just found how to get fx and fy from the magnitude and the direction, how do we find the magnitude and the direction from the components? Well, for that, you remember Pythagorean theorem. If we have a triangle, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, or the magnitude is equal to the square root of fx squared plus fy squared. Not same thing, but theta. Also, we use trig, in this case, inverse. This angle here, theta, is equal to the inverse tangent of the opposite over the adjacent. In this case, it's inverse tangent because we are finding the angle, not taking the tangent of the angle. But this is another place where we have to be careful that this is fy over fx because theta is here, right? Y is the opposite, x is the adjacent. But if this was theta, or I labeled this as theta and wanted to find this angle, my opposite would be x and my adjacent would be y. So for this angle, theta would be tan inverse fx over fy. So be careful again. Okay, so let's do this in practice. What is the magnitude and direction of a vector A? In this case, I didn't give it any units, which is fine, as long as it has some magnitude and a direction. And I made a typo here. This should be 3, negative 4, right? Because this vector is pointing down below the x-axis. So its x component is positive 3, y component is negative 4. So over here in the question, it should be 3, comma, negative 4. So I want the magnitude and the direction. Magnitude, Pythagorean theorem, it's square root of ax squared plus ay squared, or 3 squared plus negative 4 squared, which is just positive 16. So we get a is the square root, or magnitude of a is the square root of 25, or just 5. Right, it's a 3, 4, 5 triangle. The length of this vector is 5. For the angle theta, I need to be careful about which angle I'm talking about. So if we do ay over ax, we get tan inverse of that is 53.1 degrees. So what angle am I talking about? If I use this relationship here, theta equals inverse tan of y over ax, am I talking about this angle or this angle? Well, the way I've organized it, ay is my opposite, and ax is my adjacent. So it would be this angle here. My opposite is ay, my adjacent is ax. If I was talking about this angle here, this one that is away from the y-axis, then I would have to use ax over ay. So this way I get 53.1 degrees, and so the way I would state, if my magnitude is 5 and my angle is 53.1, that's still not quite enough, Because given those two, if I just told you A is 5 long and 53.1 degrees, I need to tell you 53.1 degrees in what, I need, like, you know, that's just an angle. Is it 53.1 degrees from positive y or north of east, whatever? So the way I chose to say it is below the x-axis. We said the way we solved the problem, it's this angle here with opposite y, adjacent x. So it's this angle, and the way I described it is below the x-axis. You could also say that it is south of east, right? That angle here, east is positive x, south is, well, below that. So that's another way I could describe it. Another way I could do it, if I wanted to describe this angle here, the one that I mentioned before that's between our vector and the y-axis, the negative y-axis. In that case, well, I could do tan inverse of the ax over ay, or I could just do 90 degrees minus that original 53.6 or 53.1 that we found here, right? So that's a right angle. So this is just 90 minus that. And now I have 36.9 degrees east of south is one way I could say that, right? Here's my angle here. This direction, negative y, is south, and this vector is east of that, rotated east. I could also say, in this case, maybe counterclockwise from the negative y-axis, or I could say to the right of the negative y-axis, something like that. Whenever you're answering a question, just be, whatever answer you write down in circle, just ask yourself, if I was given just this, would that be enough information for me to draw this vector? The answer is no, you need to be more specific. Questions about finding components or finding magnitude and direction? Okay. Let's talk about what's a force. I said before to just think of it as a push and a pull, right? So I can apply a force to this chair in a bunch of different directions. So there's some magnitude, how hard I push it, and of course the direction, which direction I apply that force. I don't know how many more ways I could say that. And what it does is it changes the motion of an object. So the motion of an object, or at least the change in it, is determined by the net force on the object. So a force, let's say I push this to the right, it'll move to the right. I changed its motion. If I apply a force to the left, it moves to the left. I changed its motion. But the important part is that it is the net force. If I apply both the force to the right and to the left, I'm clearly applying force. My shoulders are working, but it's not moving because I have an equal amount of force to the left and right. If I add those two together, tip to tail, I get zero. My net force is zero. So there is no change in the motion. So it's the net force that matters when we're actually trying to figure out what is happening to an object's motion. And also, we're going to try to be very specific about this, especially in the beginning, but it's important to say forces are on something by something, or by something on. It doesn't matter exactly what terminology you use, but in this case, this is a force by me on the chair. Or a force on the chair by me. It doesn't matter how you say it. But when we have a system with a bunch of different things interacting, it's really useful to be specific about what is doing what, especially when we get into Newton's laws, which have equal and opposite reactions. And anyway, that's down the road. But be specific, it'll help with your organization. So let's solve a little problem here. So our example is a picture hanging on the wall. So we're told that our F net is zero. There is no motion. This thing is completely still. It's just hanging on a wall. So all the forces have to add up to F net equals zero. Because if there was a net force, it would have its motion, which is stationary, would be changing, which is not. So what forces apply here? Well, everything on Earth has gravity acting on it, right? And we know gravity pulls down. So I say the most specific way I could say this is F by gravity on the picture. We'll just simplify that to FG, because in this case, we only have one thing. It's our picture. So all the forces are going to be acting on the picture. So FG points straight down, only in the y direction. Then we have these strings that the picture is hanging from that are preventing it from falling, F1 and F2, which are both just F by some string on the picture, but we'll call them F1 and F2 for convenience, those both have a horizontal component and a vertical component. Right? F1 is going up and left, F2 is going up and right. And we know that they all have to add up to 0. So let's test that out. We know that to add them up, we just pick them up and put them tip to tail. But actually, there's an intermediate. I mean, this isn't really a step, but just something that you might see, that you will certainly see in the future, is if we just take all the forces and put them starting at the same point. So here are all our forces spread out however I chose to draw them. Maybe it makes it intuitive. And I just pick them up and put them at the same point. This is called a free body force diagram or a free body diagram. This is just a really common way to concisely show the forces acting on an object. The object is just the point in the center. I don't care about, like when I'm pushing this chair, I don't care about its shape or whether I'm pushing here or pushing right here or whatever, right? It's just a chair. It's an object. That's our point. Here's my force on it. So there are forces. Let's add them up. Let's start with F1, right? F1 was going up and to the left. We take F2, which goes up and to the right, put that tip to tail with F1, and then finally FG, force of gravity, just goes straight down, put that tip to tail with F2, and we get right back where we started. So now our start and our end point are right here. Our F net is just 0, which is what we wanted, right? There's no net force. So this setup here works out. These three forces add to 0. Let's do this component by component. So we can break up F1 and F2 into their x and y components. Like we just, I mean, we said, because we know how to describe things, like F2 goes, well, right and up. Or and putting that in terms of our x and y, it has an x component and a y component, positive x and positive y. So if we break that up into its components, they look like these pink arrows here. F2x points to the right, however much F2 went in the x direction, and F2y goes up, however much F2 went in the y direction. Very similar thing for F1, except F1x is pointing in the negative x direction. F1 is negative. F1y is also positive, just like F2y. And then F gravity points straight down. So it has no x component, only FGY. So all of F gravity is pointing in the y direction. So we don't need to break it down anymore. So if we want to solve this component by component graphically, we can just add these individual vectors. Right? So like I said before, we can think of F1 and F1, F1x and F1y as just like lengths. Right? That's the length of F1 in the x direction and the y direction. Or we could also think of them as their own vectors. Both are correct, right? One way is just like describing the length of this vector. But at the end of the day, if I have a force that's applied diagonally, or like some x, some y to something, that will act, that single force will act the same way as one separate force in the y direction and one separate force in the x direction that work together, as long as they're scaled appropriately, so that they add up to that same vector. But so this breaking things down completely into x and y applies at all levels, whether it's vector addition or algebra, whatever you do. Anyway, let's add them up. So the x components, remember we just had one going left, one going right. I put some separation in between them here just so we can see it more clearly. But if we add F1 to F2, put it tip to tail, we get right back where we started. In the x direction, f net x is 0. F1x plus f2x is 0. Great. Same thing with the y direction. I take f1, y, add f2y to it, goes up again. But then fg, tip to tail with those, brings us back down to the start. And we get f net y is also 0. So now our f net is 0, 0, which we can just write as F net equals 0, which is good. That's what we wanted. We can also do the algebra like written out. So first, our x direction, our F net x is equal to 0, right? which is what we want. And that's just equal to the sum of f1x plus f2x. And so we can solve that, and we just find that f1x equals negative f2x, that they're equal and opposite, which makes sense, right? Gravity has no horizontal component. So if one string is pulling left and one string is pulling right, and there's no net force, however hard, they must be equal and opposite. However hard this one pulls me left has to be how hard this one pulls me right in order for it to not move. So that relationship makes good sense. Now in the y direction, we have f1y plus f2y, but we also have this fgy. And if we solve that, and all those add up to zero for the same reason, if we solve that, we can see that f1y plus f2y, the total force, remember these are both positive, the total force that the strings are pulling up is equal to the total force of gravity downward, equal and opposite. Right? However hard these two are pulling up together, gravity is pulling equally hard down. Each individual y component from the two strings, f1y and f2y, is smaller than fgy. Right? They're only taking, the way I've drawn it symmetrically, so it would be half the load. Right? Each one is doing half, but combined, they have the same total, and everything adds to zero. Questions on this example? So F net being zero, net force being zero, means the motion does not change. So if it's still, it stays still. All right, here's a bit of a tricky one. We have a cabinet on a truck, and everything is stationary here. The truck is not opening or closing anymore. It's stuck like this. The cabinet is not sliding. So it's just cabinet sitting on a truck, stationary. We want to know what direction the force of the truck applies on the cabinet. So we have the cabinet here, and I'll give you a little hint. F net is zero, because there's no motion here. The cabinet is at rest and staying at rest. What direction is the force by the truck on the cabinet in order for the cabinet to not move? So think about what other forces, the truck definitely applies a force, what other force is acting on the cabinet, and which way does that act? And we know it, they have to add up to zero. Give you another minute or so with this. Ten more seconds. All right, I like to see this. So we're thinking, we're disagreeing. There's at least one, I saw at least one answer for every option. So we're split. The correct answer is B, but I will admit this is a pretty tricky one. So I think in this case, our intuition leads us astray, at least at first, without having more information, because we see the truck, and we know, OK, well, the truck is at an angle, so it's like going to push that way, like outward from the truck bed. But then also, it wants to slide. Or I don't know, we think about friction, a bunch of stuff. But at the end of the day, we can think about it as just, well, there's a force of gravity. Gravity always pulls straight down, right, toward the Earth, and then my net is zero. So whatever the force is, however it breaks down up here, the truck has to cancel out gravity. So if gravity goes straight down, the truck has to go, the force from the truck on the cabinet has to go straight up. Down plus up is zero. Done. But we know that, well, I mean, we didn't know yet. We'll learn, and we'll do more of this later on. But the force from the truck is not just, I mean, like, there's no, it's made up of two different forces. There's the normal force, which we'll talk more about as we go. But that's the force that keeps, you know, when something is sitting on something else, that's the force that keeps it there. So my water bottle's sitting on the desk, gravity's pulling it down, the force that the table exerts on the water bottle so it doesn't fall through it is called the normal force. Normal means perpendicular. And so, I mean, that it applies perpendicular to that surface. So in this case, the cabinet is sitting on the truck bed. What keeps the cabinet from falling through it? It's the normal force. And it's perpendicular to the truck bed. So that's this Fn that's going out and perpendicular. But then we also have friction. That keeps it from sliding down, right? If the truck had a bed made of ice or it was covered in oil or something, super slippery, we know this wouldn't happen. The cabinet would slide down, right? If I just have something on a flat surface and I start tilting the flat surface, that thing's going to slide right off, unless there's friction that keeps it from sliding. And it turns out that we get this vertical total force from the truck bed that cancels out gravity by adding up this normal force and the frictional force. You can pretty much see it here. If I took the normal force, picked it up, and put it tip to tail with this frictional force, F sub little f, then we get this vertical. They make a triangle. Or if I take the frictional force and I add it tip to tail with the normal force, they add up to give me this total F surface, as it's labeled here. So that stuff will see more as we do more problems and break down forces in different planes and stuff like that. But the key takeaway here, the part that we want to be responsible for this lecture, is that Fg goes down. And so if we want net to be zero, the resulting compensation from the truck is straight up. All right, questions about this example? Yep, those two added together. So if we took, I don't know if everyone can see this, but if gravity, and people online definitely can't, but if gravity goes straight down, then the normal force goes up and to the right. This clearly doesn't add up to zero, right? If I took this vector and I put it tip to tail with this one, we have this result that's like that. And to get back to zero. So this is our frictional force. So I don't know how useful that diagram was, but I was really just recreating this, moving this there. But these two add up to give me the total force from the surface of the truck. OK. So now we've talked a little bit about forces, used them a couple times to show how they balance out. But the two examples we looked at had F net equals zero. So no net force. So no motion, or no change in motion on an object. And the way we talk about motion, so I say motion, and it's very clear what no motion is. It's just not moving. But when we do have motion, we describe it with momentum. Momentum is also a vector quantity, which means it has a magnitude and a direction. And it's just the mass times the velocity. So this momentum vector p, it's a lowercase p, unlike pressure, which is a capital letter. And pressure is also a scalar, so it doesn't have a direction. So momentum is this vector p, which is a scalar mass times a velocity. So an object, let's say we have two objects moving at the same speed. The heavier one has more momentum. Or if we have two objects that are the same mass, the one that's moving faster has more momentum. So giving an object more mass or more speed, both up its momentum. Another word tossed around with momentum a lot is inertia, which is just like it's basically how hard it is to move or stop an object. A very heavy object, you need a lot of force to move it, that like it has a lot of inertia that keeps it from moving. And if it is moving very fast, it's very hard to stop it. because it has a big mass. A very light object is easy to get moving and easy to stop. It has a small mass, so at the same velocity as a bigger object, it's a lot easier. It has a lot less momentum, a lot easier to stop or start. The way we change momentum or change motion of an object is by applying a force. And the other important thing here is time. So delta P, our change in momentum, so I have some motion. In those cases, before it was zero, I'm still. And if I want to give motion, introduce some momentum, I get a delta P, right? A change in momentum. And that happens when I apply a force, F net, over time, delta T. So my change in momentum is equal to my net force times the amount of time I apply it for. Right? So here's this chair, and I'm going to give it some, I'm going to apply a force to it, and clearly there's some delta P, right? I gave it some momentum, so it gained motion, started moving. But if I apply a force, like the amount of time also is important, right? If I just apply the force for a half second, it doesn't gain as much momentum. But if I apply the force for a full second, it gains a lot more momentum. So the amount of momentum that something gains, the amount, the change in something's motion is affected not only by the strength of the force and its direction, right? It matters whether the force is applied to the left, I give motion to the left, or if I apply the force to the right, it gives motion to the left, or sorry, right to the right. It's also the amount of time. The longer I apply this force for, the more and more motion, the more and more momentum I will transfer to something. We also use this term impulse, denoted by the letter J. J is just delta P. It's the change in momentum. So when I apply a force over time, I apply some impulse to an object that changes its momentum by delta P. This really isn't like a new concept. It has the same units as momentum, or it's force times time. It's just, I was going to say convenient, but I don't really think it's that convenient. I usually just think of delta P equals force times delta T. But we might throw around the term impulse, and that just means, you know, the change in momentum. When I apply an impulse to something, its momentum changes by that amount. A key thing to notice here is that we're looking at a delta P, not, so you don't need a force to just have momentum, right? If this chair is rolling across, so it's not going to actually do it because there's a lot of friction here, but let's see this, say this chair is just moving without me touching it, moving across the floor with a constant velocity or a constant momentum, which is just its velocity times mass. There's no change in its motion. There's some constant vector P, some constant momentum. I only need a force in order to change that. So if it's still and I apply a force, it will start moving, go from zero to some P final. But it also could have some P initial, and then I apply a force to it that brings it to a rest. There is some delta P from P initial to zero, even though its P final is zero. So an object can still be moving if F net is zero. It just has constant momentum. So like let's, and even another example with this chair, if I'm pushing equally hard on the left and the right as it slides across, it has a constant momentum, which is not zero, but the net force on it is zero. So it's only going to have a delta P go from PI, P initial to P final, if there's some net force. We can also talk about momentum of a system of more than one object. And in that case, the total momentum of the system is just the sum of all the momenta. These are all vectors, but now we know how to add vectors, right? If these are, you know, we just add them tip to tail. So we can find the total momentum of a system. And then if you remember back to 7a, we have closed systems and open systems. In a closed system, there's no, in 7a, it was no energy is being introduced or dissipated from the system. Here, closed system means F net is zero, which means our total momentum is constant. Our delta P total from final to initial is zero. So that just means that this value does not change over time for a closed system. But the individual pieces of that system can exchange momentum. If I just had a, as we'll see on the next slide, I think, if I just had a system with two objects, one that has P1, one that has P2, P1 can give some momentum to P2, P2 can give it back to P1, whatever. They can interact a bunch as long as the total stays the same in this closed system. If we have an open system, that means F net is not zero. There's some net force applied to all these objects in the system, and so we're going to have some net change in momentum, some delta P total. And that delta P total, like we saw before, is just equal to the net force times the delta T. And there can be a combination between those two things happening as well, right? In this case, we could have delta P total change, or P total change, have some non-zero delta P total, and have the individual pieces exchange momentum and stuff like that. But we'll do a lot of examples with these. The way we keep track of all this could just be equations, right? Here's our P total is P1 plus P2 plus P3, whatever. And we know that this is really, in two dimensions, two equations, right? When we do math with vectors, we want to break it into our x and our y components. So we can have one of these that's P total x is P1x plus P2x plus P3x, whatever. And that's completely independent from the other equation we could write, which is P total y equals P1y plus P2y plus P3y. And then we also have initial and final. So we have our starting state and our ending state. That's how we get this delta P total and our delta t here from initial time to final time. So there's a lot of different things to keep track of when you have a system of multiple objects that you're trying to keep track of the momentum of each one and the whole system. So we're gonna use these momentum charts. So there's a lot going on here. Probably should have had it pop up little by little, but let's just walk through it together. So first, let's focus on what's happening physically in the system, which is the top part of this slide. We have one ball that has a smaller mass, m1, that's moving toward a ball that's heavier, m2, and it hits it. Right? So before, it's moving towards the stationary ball. After, they've collided, ball 1 stops, and ball 2 keeps going. So we just have one ball moving toward the other, hits it, first one stops, and the other goes. It's a very simple collision, and we've made it simpler because it's all happening in the x direction. Right? So we only need a single set of equations for the x direction. There's no up and down motion for anything here. So we introduce this momentum chart. And it has columns for our initial momentum, our change in momentum, and then our final. So from left to right, this reads like an equation. I mean, it is. P initial plus delta P, so our initial value plus our change, is equal to our final. So every individual column in this chart just gives us this plus this equals that, this plus this equals that, so on and so forth. So that's a great way to check if it's correct. The columns are the different objects, and those add up to the total. So in my P initial column, I have the initial momentum of ball 1 plus the initial momentum of ball 2 is my total initial momentum. Same thing, change in ball 1 plus change in ball 2 is my total change. And for final, final momentum of ball 1 plus final ball 2 is our final total. So across, this is what's happening to each individual object and our whole system. And down, this is what's happening at any point in time, my initial, my during, I guess, my delta, and my final. So this is really three equations that we are, well, I guess a lot more than that. It's 1, 2, 3 across and 1, 2, 3 down. So it's six equations here because we have an initial, a delta, and a final, and we have ball 1, ball 2, and a total. But when we write it out like this, it actually makes it pretty, if not simple, straightforward sometimes. To solve. So how would we go, I mean, it's already filled in, but how would we go about filling this in? Well, our before and after picture pretty much give us all the information we need. So a key thing that I always like to do first is identify, is something a closed system or an open system? In this case, it's a closed system. There's no external forces here. Our whole system is these two balls, and they might collide and share momentum with each other, but there's nothing that will add or take away from the total. So the first thing I can do here is put this zero in here. What this zero means is that my total change in momentum, so my delta P total is zero. My P total is constant because my F net is zero. There's no external force. So there's my first one here. Then let's take the initial row. Let's do the rest of this row. So I have ball one that's moving to the right. Right? So there, that's enough to just draw this arrow here. My momentum is m1, its mass, times v, its velocity, which gives me an arrow pointing to the right. Great. Ball 2 is stationary, so we'd get m2 times 0, so that's 0. So there's these two, and then our total column is, like we said, this is an equation, and we have two pieces of it. This plus that equals that, so this right arrow plus 0 is just the right arrow. What this column is saying is that initially, I have a ball at rest and a ball moving here. This one has momentum, this one doesn't. So the entirety of the system's momentum is just the momentum of ball one that is moving, right? This momentum plus this momentum is just the momentum of ball one. Then we know that we have our total initial, and we know that our delta total is zero. So this amount of momentum plus zero means our final total has to be the same. Right? That's the meaning of saying our delta P total is zero, that our initial and our final stay the same. So let's go even further. Let's do ball two. Let's go through this row here. We know that ball two starts at rest, so that should be zero. And we know that afterwards, ball two is moving to the right. So same argument as up here. We know that the final momentum for ball two is just going to be its mass times its final velocity, or we get some right arrow here. And then we know that to get from zero to this vector, what do we have to add to it? What's our delta P? Well, it's just this whole vector, right? To get zero plus what equals this, it's just that. What else can we fill in there? Now we know our delta P total is zero, right? So what this is saying is that there's no net change, so they can only exchange momentum, right? Whatever ball one loses, ball two gains, and vice versa. So if ball two gains this amount of momentum, it has to all come from ball one. Delta P ball one is just equal and opposite to delta P of ball two. That way their changes add up to zero. What really just happened was ball one had all this momentum, gave it all to ball two. So now ball one has none, ball two has it all. And we know the final momentum of ball one is zero because it stopped. So now going through once again, the story this whole chart tells us is that ball one initially has some momentum, hits ball two and comes to a stop, so it loses all of its momentum. Ball two is at rest, gets hit by ball one, gains this momentum, and so now is moving at the end. And in total, this system has some initial momentum. There's no net force, so the total momentum for the system stays the same throughout the whole time. Vertically, that just means initially ball one's moving, so our total is just ball one. In the middle, they're exchanging, and the exchange has to be completely closed, so whatever one gains, the other loses. And finally, the other one's moving with the initial momentum. So if we wanted to actually get some numbers out of this, which you will in DL, we can write out these equations. So this works, our arrows tell the story here. I mean, the numbers are in here, but our arrows are enough. Usually we'll just fill these in with arrows, and it just means right plus left is zero, zero plus right is right, right plus zero is right. Anyway, these also we can just write down as equations. This would mean that mv1 or m1v plus whatever delta p is equals zero. So that would tell us that this delta p is just negative m1v, right? Same thing with ball 2. That would mean 0 plus whatever this delta p is equals m2vf. So we know that this delta p is m2vf. We can also do it vertically, right? We know that 0 plus m2vf equals m1v. So that gives us a relationship between their masses and their velocities. So I'm not going to go too much further with this. You'll play around with this in DL. But this is how to use momentum charts. And this is also, you're going to start a little bit simpler. When on the work you do, you'll start with ones that just have a single row, right? This could just be a ball going through the air, or that gets hit, or something like that. So I'll leave it to you to kind of see the usefulness of these. So let's do one more quick question before we finish. We have two carts, both with the same mass, moving with velocities that are equal and opposite each other. So they have the same speed, the same magnitude of their velocity, but one's going left and one's going right, and they collide. So my question to you is, which of these final states is not possible if there's no external force? So no external force means initial and final momentum have to be the same. There cannot be a net change in our total momentum. So which one of these could not be the result? Give you about 30 more seconds with this. All right. Nice work on this one. The answer is B. How do we know that? Well, we know there's no net force, so our initial total momentum is the same as our final total momentum, or there's no delta P total. So what is that initial momentum? We have mv going right, right? Momentum is m times v, so we have mv in the positive x direction and mv in the negative x direction, so those two are equal and opposite, and they cancel to 0. So if our initial momentum is 0, our final momentum also has to be 0. And when I say momentum, I mean total momentum, because our F net is 0. So P initial is P final. They're both 0. So which one of these is not a total of 0? Well, D is easy. Neither of them are moving, so M times 0 is 0. Fine. Final momentum is 0. This one describes them just coming together and sticking in the middle. C, they hit and then they bounce off, and now they're moving in opposite directions. This is still okay, because now we still have an mv going left and an mv going right, and so they cancel out to 0. Mv plus negative mv is 0. Now they're on opposite sides of each other, right? Now they're moving apart, but the total momentum is the same as the initial. So this just describes them moving toward each other and then bouncing off with the same speed. And that is called an elastic collision. We'll talk a lot about that later on as well, but that's when these things bounce off each other and they lose no energy. A, very similar to C, except now they're moving a bit slower, so they did lose some energy, but the total is still 0. Mv over 2 this way, mv over 2 that way, they cancel each other and add to 0. B is the only one where the total is not 0, because they're both moving to the left, and so we have some net total momentum to the left. And yeah, that's impossible. If we started with 0, we have to end with 0. So it's impossible. That's all I have for today. Remember, you do have a quiz next week, and it will be on this lecture material, as well as the DLs that are this week. I believe that's 9 and 10. So just vectors and intro force momentum stuff. Capacitors and exponential change will not be on your quiz next Tuesday.